need some headphones?
No.
Okay. Because there's a couple pairs around here. The splendor of the key. Clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light. And darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice. It trembles at his voice. How great is our God. God.
Good, good, good morning, caring community. Happy Father's Day. Welcome. We are so glad that you are here with us in person and online. Would you join us this morning as we proclaim that this is the Father's house and failure and shame are not welcome in this place? Would you stand with us this morning? And my piano's working this time. We did this song, it wasn't, so we're excited. Sometimes
on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength.
My story isn't over, my story's just begun. Failure won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. Failure won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house, check your shame at the door, cause it ain't welcome anymore.
Would you be seated for announcements this morning?
It's good to be in the Father's house this morning. But you know what? This is good, but this is not what awaits us. We have a mansion awaiting us. And while we're here, this Father's house is used for many things. In case you thought that trellis there with the fake roses on it was for prettying up things for Father's Day, it wasn't. There was a beautiful wedding here yesterday. I don't see him here. I didn't expect him to be here this morning. But Jason and Miranda are now Mr. and Mrs. So if you see them, congratulate them. Praise God for what took place. And it was a monumental team effort yesterday by a lot of people in this church. They were, I think Carol Palm was kind of de facto head of it. At least I went to her and I said, what do you call this catering / wedding planning group? And she said, one and done. That's what it was called. So, but they did an awesome job and they turned it back into a worship area for us this morning. So thank them and praise God for what he did. A couple of announcements. Baby bottle blast is starting today. Maybe you noticed the container right outside the doorway there with the baby bottles in it. We usually do that on Mother's Day, and we collect them on Father's Day. But because of COVID and all that goes on, it was a slight delay. But this support, Capital Area Pregnancy Center, they do the Lord's work. They save innocent lives, and many times they touch the very souls of women and men in the pregnancy. So we have been supporting them for a long, long time. I pray that, and their fundraising has been hurt this year greatly because of COVID. So I pray that you would continue to do what God has always led you to do each and every year. Take a bottle and fill it up. Hands and feet were supposed to restart today, but some emergencies in their family. You probably read about an email and whatnot and prayer requests, but Avery's doing much better, so is Trish. But they're going to restart on July 5th, a couple Sundays from now. And in the meantime, they need some plastic tubs for storage and also donations to hold the clothing. Except the underwear. They can take underwear, men's and women's, and socks as well. Plus, there is now a sign-up. I got to click on the address, and you can sign up to prepare meals for each Sunday. Friday, this coming Friday, the 26th, around 9 p.m., we're going to have a drive-in movie out here. You just pull up in your car, turn your radio on, and we'll have it all set up this coming Friday. Next Sunday at 7 p.m. here at the church, there's going to be a leadership meeting that we're going to talk about reopening all ministries, Sunday school ministries. So if you're a part of that, particularly in leadership, you want to show up next Sunday at 7 p.m. and talk about that and give your thoughts on reopening the rest of the ministry. And also next week as well would be a VBS rally on Wednesday, July 1st. VBS rally here at the church from 6:30 to 8:30. So that's the announcements in a nutshell. I know one prayer request, Vicky's nephew is currently in the hospital on a ventilator, not doing very well. He's 32 years old, grossly overweight, and the question is of his salvation. So we want to take a moment to lift Ronnie up to the Lord. Lord, we just ask that you intervene in this man's life. In that hospital room on a ventilator, Lord, as his mind goes through life, I pray, Lord, that if he has not cried out to you yet, that at this moment he would. He would put aside all of life, come to you in repentance of his sins, and truly understand who you are, that you are the Father, that you are the Father who invites him into your kingdom. Into your house. Lord, I pray that you would meet him right where he's at. Lord, I pray for Capillary Pregnancy Center. Thank you for those who serve through that ministry and the lives that they save and touch. Thank you for caring what you have done through caring in support of that ministry. And I pray, Lord, that you would open hearts and pocketbooks and continue that. Now, Father, we want you to come into this room because we know things, lives change when you are in the room. We invite you and your Holy Spirit to minister to us today. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Worship team.
Let's join us again as we worship and praise this beautiful name. Thank you.
Stop working, you never stop.
You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop. You never stop working. Never stop. You never stop.
Another
Dear Father, we thank you for being the father of the thief, the doubter, the coward, the prisoner, the soldier, the young, the old, those who are hungry, those who are poor, those who are princes, those who have failed, those who dream, those who are suffering, those who have loved, the chained, the unfree, those who have been let down, who have lost, that you call each one of them found if they come to you. They come to your table with infinite seats welcoming each one of us. Jesus, we're so thankful to have a perfect Father in you. We're so thankful for those who have been such a great example to us, who have represented that fatherly love here on earth for us to just get a glimpse at. Would you be with Pastor Sheldon as he preaches this message for us this morning? In your precious name, amen. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, worship team. Beautiful worship this morning, and it seemed like the theme running through that worship is the Father, Heavenly Father, patiently waiting for all who call upon Him. You might hear that later on today. A couple weeks ago, I spoke to you about God's covenant with us. First, with all mankind through Noah and the rainbow, and second, through Abraham and the nation of Israel, His people. And within those covenants, we saw His grace demonstrated. In the Old Testament, through His people, through the nation of Israel, we saw it demonstrated. And in the New Testament, it's demonstrated through the church. I'm talking about the universal church, the body of believers, the church with the big C, you and I. And in the Old Testament, through the Jews, or the New Testament, through the church of God's people, we were called to be agents of grace. Today's Father's Day, and I want to look in God's economy. The first agent of grace was the Father. I'm not talking about the Heavenly Father. He's the author of grace. All grace flows through Him. I'm talking about earthly fathers. God's design for society begins with stable and thriving families. And God's design for stable and thriving families begins with the Father. Let me pause. I am not taking nothing away from motherhood. Many, many single moms are fighting the great fight. It's not meant to be that way, though. They are many times swimming upstream without a paddle. It's a struggle. It's not meant to be that way, because fatherhood is about responsibility, being responsible for your family. It's been God's design beginning. Let's go back to the Garden of Eden. When Adam and Eve sinned and disobeyed God, let's look at chapter 3 and how God responded. Chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. It says, then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, where are you? We know it's a rhetorical question. God knew where he's at. But he asked the question because he wanted to solicit a response from Adam. We know what the response was. Adam eventually blamed Eve, who eventually blamed the serpent. But the point is, God called to the man. He knew exactly what happened, And he knew exactly why it happened, but yet he also knew that Adam was ultimate responsible, because Adam was the one who got the original instructions. Then you fast forward to Genesis 18. We know that Abraham was the man that God called to raise up the nation of Israel through. He was the father of the Jews. He had great responsibility. And at a time in history when God was about to deal with the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, we see this little conversation. Genesis 18, a couple verses, 17 through 19. Said, then the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do? Abraham will surely become a great and powerful nation, and all nations will be blessed through him. For I have chosen him so that he will direct his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing what is right and just, so that the Lord will bring about for Abraham what he has promised him. See, it's been God's plan all along. When things go wrong, God knows exactly what is needed. He tells us in his word. If you remember 2 weeks ago, I talked about the time between the Old Testament and the New Testament. It was 400 years of silence. Not a word of revelation from God to his people. Not a word. But do you remember the last thing he said to them before that 400 years? Raise your hand if you know it was in Malachi. There's one hand come up. Malachi chapter 4. Malachi is obviously the last book in the Old Testament. Chapter 4 is the last chapter in Malachi. And we're going to look at the last two verses in chapter 4 of Malachi. The last thing God said to his people before 400 years of silence. It says, see, I will send you the prophet Elijah before that great and dreadful day of the Lord comes. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, or else I will come and strike the land with a curse. The last thing he says to his people. Malachi was a contemporary of Nehemiah. We know what Nehemiah did. He came back from exile and helped the Jews rebuild the temple. Malachi and Nehemiah, in their prophecy, they both recognized, identified the sins of the people in Jerusalem. They rebuilt the temple, but they failed to rebuild their spiritual lives. The priesthood was corrupt. Worship, unlike ours this morning, wasn't real. They forgot about the poor, and they neglected tithing. All this is going on at that time. All these national sins are going on at this time, and God says it starts with the fathers. I don't know about you, but that's pretty powerful for this father. Starts with the father. And guess what? Guess what the first thing he says in the New Testament? Turn to Luke chapter 1. Last thing he says in the Old Testament. Now the first thing, or one of the first things he says in the New Testament. Luke chapter 1, starting with verse 11. Now this is with Zechariah, who was a priest in the temple. He was a descendant of Aaron, and so was his wife, Elizabeth. But they were up in years, and they had no children. And obviously, they were praying for that blessing. Verse 11, Luke chapter 1. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. The name means the Lord is gracious. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. Talking about John the Baptist. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. Many of the people of Israel will bring back, he will bring back to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit of the power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. John was not the prophet Elijah returning in the flesh, resurrected. But he functioned like Elijah, an Old Testament prophet who was a preacher of repentance. He was paving the way for Jesus, who would be the one that turned the hearts of the fathers back to the children. Society ills begin with the families, and family ills begin with the failures of fatherhood. Just some statistics. The impact of fatherlessness. Impact of fatherlessness can be seen in our homes, in our schools, can be seen in our hospitals and in our prisons. A documentary film called Irreplaceable says two things. It says fatherlessness is associated with almost every societal problem facing our country's children. If classified as a disease, fatherlessness would be an epidemic worthy of national emergency. 24.7 million children are in homes without fathers, and probably millions more are in a home with a father present physically, but not emotionally. 71% of teen pregnancies, children without fathers. 71% of high school dropouts, children without fathers. And while they're in school, grades 1 through 12, when they are learning, forming, 17.7 million students without fathers. 20.7% white children, 31.2% Hispanic, and 57.6% black children. Denzel Washington, in a recent interview on racism, he said the worst problem is fatherlessness. And he gave his own life as an example. He grew up with three very close friends. In the age of 13, they were all in trouble. But he had a father that cared and directed him another direction. But all three of his friends, two of them did 15 to 25 years in prison, and another did 28 years. He credits his father at that time in his life for getting him off on another direction. Larry Elder, a black talk show host, says, without fathers, you are 5 times more likely to end up poor, 9 times more likely to drop out of school, and 20 times more likely to end up in prison. We see it. We know this. I'm throwing out numbers to you, but you already know it. You see it. Fatherlessness and the impact is not something that will get airtime it deserves in the media. And we know that's because it doesn't fit their agenda. But fatherlessness and the impact of fatherhood is always in God's agenda. Always. Since creation, since the establishment of family, God has commanded us to live obediently and then pass the truth on to his children. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 6. a very well-known passage called the Shema. Shema means to hear in Hebrew. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Thank God for the new covenant. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands. Bind them as them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. I think God was trying to make a point. And the truth that is revealed to Israel at this time, that God is one. God is one. And he's one, he's not many gods with a little g, but he's one big God with the big G. And the truth is that this one God created all things, sustains all things, governs all things. That's the truth that he passed on to Israel. It was in radical opposition of all the other nations. God is one. All of Israel's neighbors, all the other nations in their daily lives, they had to deal with or come to grips with scores of gods, various gods, each one with their own little sphere of influence, their own limitations, even with their own little petty self-interest. Some examples. Marduk was the Babylonian god, and his son, Nehu, was the god of scribes and writing. So I guess if you wanted some inspiration to write a book or a poem or opinion section in a paper, you had to pray to Nehu. Nergal was the god of the underworld. He judged the dead. Shamash, I think that's how he said, he's the god of the sun. But guess what? He did double duty as god of truth, justice, and morality. Wonder if he got a little extra pay for that double duty. Dagon, fertility god. Enki, god of subterranean fresh water. And my favorite, the Vulcan, fire god. My college football team, we were the Vulcans. Can you imagine all these different gods? You know, which god handles this? Who do I pray for this? You know what? They didn't have Google back then either. Or Siri, couldn't ask her. Can you imagine? But not for Israel. Israel could live in peace with the knowledge that all things and all times were under rule of one divine king. And his, amen, amen. And his purposes, his ways were righteous. His purposes were not, for her, for Israel, for his people, and through her, was all about salvation. Their salvation and the salvation of all mankind. Salvation from what? From sin and judgment and every other evil that burdened human life. Everything. God's work, God's grace. That's what his was. That was he was all about that for Israel and for the whole world through Israel. Totally different than every other nation experiencing. Israel could live in peace. And guess what? That peace, that serenity still remains today for all who put their faith and trust in the God of Israel. Jesus says in John 16:33, Jesus said, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble. In this world you will have trouble. But take heart. Take heart, I have overcome the world. You name the trouble. You name it. Whether it's a pandemic and a fear it's brought, whether it's the economic shutdown, whether it's chaos in our cities, whether it's corrupt politicians who fail to keep their oath, like the mayor of Seattle, or whether it's corrupt media who distort facts for their own agenda. Or maybe the trouble is a little bit more personal. Maybe the pandemic has left you in fear. Maybe the shutdown has hurt you financially. Maybe it's not the chaos outside your home. Maybe there's chaos inside your home. Maybe it's not the politicians who don't keep their oath. Maybe someone close to you, family, friend, didn't keep a promise they made to you. And maybe it's not the lies of the media, but maybe it's the lies of Satan that keep you paralyzed with shame, with guilt, doubt, defeat. And maybe this day, Father's Day, you really don't have anything to celebrate. You pick the trouble. It doesn't matter, or you can pick them all. Jesus Christ is the answer. Doesn't matter. Jesus is the answer. And fathers, we have a lot of work to do. We must continue to obey God's commandments, but there's a whole lot more. Let's go back to Shema, read a couple of verses. Verse 7, impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road. When you lie down and when you get up, tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. Think God is trying to tell us something? Many Jews applied these verses literally. They actually put scripture on their foreheads in little boxes and tied them on their left arms. They put little boxes on door frames and put scripture in that. They did it literally. But God's point is that it should be the most important thing to us, a number one priority, to live in such a way that our children get it too. Let's see this video.
Dad, do you love Mom?
I do.
How much?
Gobs and gobs.
Dad,
mm-hmm.
Do you love my brother?
Connor? I do.
How much?
Gobs and gobs.
Dad,
mm-hmm.
Do you love God?
Yeah.
How much?
Gobs and gobs.
Dad,
uh-huh.
Do you love me? Dad.
I do.
How much? I already know.
Gobs and gobs.
Dad,
mm-hmm.
How much is a gob?
Well, let me put it like this. Your favorite color is yellow. And when you eat those Nutter Butter cookies, you always scrape the peanut butter out of the middle and you secretly feed it to the dog because you think the dog deserves a treat too. At nighttime, I know before you go to bed, you always pull your Barbies all together because you don't want them to be lonely. And sometimes when you get a little nervous, you bat your eyes like this. They get really, really, really fast. But when you're happy and when you're excited, you always twirl your hair right beside your ear. And you love your mama's red earrings. And you always seem to eat your green beans one at a time. You see, my love, I notice you. And I love being your daddy. and I will always be here for you. Even on your best days, even on your worst days, your daddy loves you and will always be here for you. And that, my dear, that's what a gob is.
I gob you too, Daddy.
Clearly, a father's heart turned to his child. Fathers, we need to act. But it's simple. It's simple. It's not complicated at all. Here's what we need to do. Here's what we need to do. Simple as fathers. Act justly. Love mercy. Walk humbly with your God. There's an age-old parable we're going to turn to. Probably know what it is. It's the prodigal son. But we're going to look at it a little differently. There's so much to be gleaned from that prodigal or from that parable. And we have preached from it before. But we're going to look at it, how these three acts, these three modes of action are demonstrated through that father. Luke chapter 15. I'm going to read the whole parable and then we'll break it down. Luke chapter 15, starting with verse 11. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have found food to spare, and here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe, put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For the son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. 'Your brother has come,' he replied, 'and your father has killed the fattened calf, because he has him back safe and sound.' The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him, but he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I have been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you killed a fattened calf for him.' 'My son,' the father said, 'you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we have to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.'" Let's look at it. We're going to work backwards. We're going to start at the bottom, work up. Walk humbly. This father was a demonstration of humility. twice to the younger son and once to the older son. The younger son gets his share and he takes off. The fact that he took off speaks volumes. If he took his share of the property and he stays and invests it, or he gives it to the poor, does something unselfish with it, then that'd be all good. But as soon as he gets it, he takes off. He flees to a distant country. What's he demonstrating to his father? That he doesn't want to be here anymore. He doesn't want to be under his father's rule. He wants to be free, to live however he wants to live. Maybe some of you have heard that before. I have. It's painful. It hurts. But see how this father responds. There's no rant and rage. He simply divides the property and gives it to his son. No rant or rage. I'd have been saying, whoa, whoa, whoa. No. Father simply divides the property and gives us his son. And then we see when the son returns, there was no I told you so's. No I told you so's. He simply in humility, he's trusting God to teach his son the lessons. He didn't have to say, I told you so. With the older son, we see the older son angry and accused the father of favoritism. But once again, the father doesn't meet anger with anger. In humility, he simply soft-spoken truth. He lays out the facts with his older son. He walked humbly before God. Love mercy. Again, he demonstrates mercy with both sons. When his younger son returns, we see that the father has been patiently waiting for him, because it says when the son is still far off, the father sees him. So he had to be waiting for him and sees him and has compassion for him. The father's heart continued to remain true to the son even while he was gone. Even while he was gone. He didn't give up watching, waiting, and hoping for his son returns. And we see what happens. He runs to him, hugs him, kisses him, demonstrates mercy in full display. And with the oldest son, with his selfish pouting and refusal to go inside, what's the father do? Father did nothing wrong to begin with, but he goes out to the son, pleads with him. Again, he knows that mercy is needed. The last one, acts justly. This is one sometimes we never pick up in this parable. Probably for this father, it was the hardest one to act upon. He's speaking to the older son. If you catch what he says to the older son, everything I have is yours. What's that mean? That means when the older son took his share and squandered it all, that was it. He is not about to do something that wasn't right and wasn't just and take from the older son and give it to the younger son just to protect the younger son from his consequences. He was a father who trusted God to continue to work in his son's life, even if the young son had to start all over on his own. He would not act unjustly towards the younger son, or even more importantly, to the older son. This earthly father is not only an example for all of us fathers, but he also demonstrates the heart of our Heavenly Father. Whether we are deep in sin and its indulgences and far away from the Heavenly Father like the younger son, or whether we are outwardly doing all the right things, saying all the right things, doing all the right things. We might be even sitting in church, but like the older son, we are empty inside and we are strained from the Father, the Heavenly Father. Either one of those. Or we may even be fatherless, without an earthly father. Or worse, we may be that absentee father. It doesn't matter which one you are in that scenario. The Heavenly Father is full of love and mercy. And as the songs that the worship team led us through, God is patiently, continuously awaits all who turn their hearts back to the Father. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your love and your mercy. And in, no matter what situation we find ourselves in this morning, we have seen a portrayal and we know the truth, what your word has told us time and time again, and what your living word, your son Jesus Christ, has proved to us through his death and resurrection, that you desire all of us to turn our hearts back to you. You want to be our Heavenly Father. I thank you and praise you for that, Lord. And I pray that if there's anyone today in this room, in the hearing of my voice, if that's what they need, I pray that they'll take that first step, because I know you'll be waiting for them. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Worship team.
Stand with us, please. Karen.
I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. Yes, I see it now. I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 oh. You saw my condition, out of land from the stars. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. Done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 again and again and again and again. Oh, friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 again. Again and again.
Pastor and author John Piper says the most important thing a father can do for the sake of his children is to become a new man in Christ, whose hope, happiness, and confidence are in God and not in himself. Does your heart need a surgeon? Does your soul need a friend? Turn back to Jesus. Happy Father's Day.